I've centered the entire series of the story of God around one statement, and it fits really well with the book of Genesis, but also the Bible in general. So this is our statement that we are covering throughout this entire series, and it is this. The Bible tells one big story of what God has done through Jesus Christ to rescue us from sin and death and ultimately restore his blessing to a renewed creation. Great statement. I have a problem with it. I actually have three problems with this. And my first problem starts with the game, Would You Rather? Have you guys ever played this before? Those of us that have kids, it gets out of control real quick. So it starts with, would you rather be able to fly or be invisible? Would you rather be really tall or really short? And then if you have like young boys like me, it's like, would you rather eat boogers for the rest of your life or like live in a hole? And you're like, it's really random. But one of the ones that we came up with, because we just went and watched Avengers Endgame, which is an awesome movie, if I haven't seen it yet, it was great. But one of the would you rathers we came up with was, would you rather be an extra in the greatest movie ever, like Endgame, or the lead character in a complete flop? And it gave me some thought, like, would I rather be just kind of a little part in the greatest movie ever, or the lead character in a complete flop? And honestly, here's my first problem with that statement we just read, is that I want to write my own story. I would choose to be the lead character, even if I knew that story was a dud. I, as a human being, choose to write my own story. So when I see a statement like this, where we get to be a part of this grand story, this God story, I'm like, that's cool, but I kind of like my story. And this part of who I am started in me in September 7th, 1983, which was the day I hit the terrible twos. And from there on out, I took great joy and pride in writing my own story. It was great being your own lead character. And I mean, those were the good years, right? Terrible twos, probably the best years of your life because you kind of do whatever you want and your parents are always trying to get you back in. But you are starting to learn as a human to write your own story. And I wrote my own story and it was great until it wasn't. And for many of us sitting here today, we share this same idea, where we wrote our own story, and then some point in our life, whether it was as a kid, a teenager, for some of you as an adult, some of you it's real recent, you realized that your story wasn't all that. And it was at that point that you found the Lord, and you joined His story, and you became a Christian, and it was great, and everything made sense, and then you realized it is really hard being a part of someone else's story. It was way easier for me to write my own story, to do what I wanted, the way I wanted it, for the reasons that I wanted to do it, than it is to join God's story, to join this other story, no matter how good it is. And as a young believer, I came in, I joined God's story, and honestly, about 10% of my life changed. And I'm just going to be real open and vulnerable, and I think that a lot of us will, if we really think about it, we share the same trait. That even though I was a part of God's story, I was saved by grace, I still probably 90% of the time chose my own story. With every decision that I made, with every interaction I had with people, I still chose to not be a part of this great story, but to choose my own. And I got to the place as I grew in my faith, where now, 20 years, 20-some years later, calling myself a believer, I'm probably about an 80% my story, 20% God's story guy. Just being honest with you. And the reason why I moved, that 10% is known as something called sanctification, which is a great thing. I've got a passage up here that I love in Colossians chapter 3. It says, if then you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is seated. Sit at the right, seat of the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then also you also will appear with Him in glory. I think, yeah, that's it. Sanctification is a process. And it would be great if when we became a Christian, automatically 100% of the time we chose God's story, but we don't. I don't. This is why I have a problem with that statement, is I struggle every day to choose God's story. So I, as a young believer, I maybe 90% of the time I chose my story, 10% was God's. Now I've transitioned to 20% God's. My hope is by the time that I die, it's a 50-50 split. Let's just be honest. We're not, as human beings, we struggle with this idea of letting go of our story. So my first problem with that statement that we've chosen for this series is that I choose my story. Here's the second problem, is that you want to choose your story too. You do. You want to choose it too. And some of you may be thinking, how dare he judge me like this? Like, he doesn't know who I am. Well, here's the thing. You're a human, I'm a human, so we share this thing. But also, the Bible gives me some freedom to do this. The next passage I want to bring up here is from, I missed a box. Skip this one, Jennifer. Galatians 6, 1 through 2 says this. Brothers, if anyone is caught in any transgression, you who are spiritual should restore him in the spirit of gentleness. This doesn't mean that we get each other's face out of arrogance or thinking that we're better than them, but in gentleness. Keep watch on yourself, lest you are tempted too. Bear one another's burdens. This is the beauty of the church. And so fulfill the law of Christ. The reason why I can tell you that you don't choose God's story every time too is because we are brothers and sisters in Christ. And I know as human beings that this is our issue. This is our flaw. This is why we struggle day after day to be a child of God. That was the second reason why I have a problem with this statement. The third reason why I have a problem with it, and I just want to preface, I love this statement, but I just have these issues that I want to bring up as we step into this crazy passage we're going to study today, and that is this. Not only do I ever want to lead my own life, write my own story, and you want to write your own story, but we want our stories to be better than each other's, right? We want to outdo each other when it comes to our stories, and I saw a great example of this 2 weeks ago when I was at my daughter's fifth grade retreat. So in the school districts out here, all fifth graders get to go on a retreat together. So we had about 200 kids from Frank Love and Shelton View went out to Camp Cedar Springs. We spent 2.5 days of mayhem, and multiple times I wanted just to walk home because they're fifth graders. But a big portion of this camp is every free time, here's what the fifth graders do. And some of you guys may have heard this before. Some of you guys, it's brand new. My accent will butcher it. But they gravitate to this game called Gaga Ball. G-A-G-A ball, Gaga ball. And what Gaga ball is everything wrong in humanity in the same spot at once. So what they do, and I wish I had a picture of this, but there's basically an octagon. I'm kind of convinced this is where MMA came from. But there's this octagon, mud pit, where these kids, there's a fence this high, and these kids all jump in, there's 200 of them in this octagon mud pit area, and a dodgeball. Can anything go right in this situation? No. So the idea of the game is you got to hit the dodgeball, and if it hits you below the knee, you're out, right? Fun game, and the last person standing wins, and then they all jump in again, and they do it again. But here's the reality, and here's why it makes sense for me when it comes to this idea of our own stories, is we are in the middle of Western Washington in this beautiful camp setting, surrounded by mountains, surrounded by the beauty of God's creation, and yet 200 fifth graders pack into this mud pit, and what they do the entire time is they fight. They say, "Dad hit you, you're out. I'm not out, hit me above the knee. That person shouldn't be in." And they just, there's this mass Lord of the Flies kind of experience where they're just constantly going out with each other. And I had this moment as I'm watching it, looking around me saying, this is life. This is what happens when I choose my story, as I get inside this octagon, this mud pit, and I focus on making myself king. Making myself the top dog, and I forget to look around and say, what am I doing in this mud pit? Why am I choosing to get in, day out, into this octagon with everyone else who, honestly, I really don't care what they think about me, and impress them, and be one up on them? C.S. Lewis put it in a great way, and I've got this quote up here, and you've probably read it before. It says this, "It would seem that our Lord finds our desires not too strong, but too weak. We are half-hearted creatures fooling around with drink and sex and ambition when infinite joy is offered us. Like an ignorant child who wants to go on making mud pies in a slum because he cannot imagine what is meant by the offer of a holiday at the sea." Today we're going to step into a portion of scripture that's basically a soap opera. And my hope is that you actually can kind of see yourself within it. because it's easy to glaze over stories like this and say, they crazy, I'm good, nothing to learn from here, but it's not true. The ridiculous that comes from us choosing our story is plain to see in this passage, and I hope that you leave today realizing it's plain to see in your life often too. But before we go there, let me pray for us, and then we'll jump in. Father, thank you for the opportunity to open your word today. Lord, I pray that it is inspiring, that we are receptive to it, that we don't remember dumb stories like Gargabal, but we remember your word and the truth that comes from it. And Father, as we leave, I pray that we can unpack it in our own hearts, through conversations in the car, through our small groups, through our family time, and that we can be changed because of it. It's in your name we pray. Amen. So I want to thank Andrew for reading the passage today, but that wasn't quite enough scripture for me, so we're going to jump back in to find context on this story, because context, as we know, can be the reason why we understand God and the reason why we don't. One of the biggest challenges that Christians have today is we just flip through the Bible and say, here's the truth for me, and we don't realize that there is actually story behind it, and that's where this big story of God comes in. But there's context to this passage that we need to remind ourselves of, and that's this, is that Jacob was sent by his mom and dad to find a wife that wasn't, in biblical terms, heathen or not of God, right? So he's traveling through the wilderness with a caravan of people, and he comes across, he's actually trying to make his way to his uncle Laban's house. He comes across this setting where there's shepherds, and he feels like he's getting close, and he's starting to ask questions to the shepherds of, do you know Laban? And they're like, yeah, he just lives over the hill. And that's where we come into this story right here. So this is going to be up on the screen, but I'm going to read another chunk of scripture here to give us some context for what we're going to study today, and that is Genesis chapter 29, verses 9 through 30. Get ready for it. Andrew wasn't lying. We're in the Bible today. Okay, verse 9. While he was still speaking to them, this is Jacob, Rachel came from her father's, with her father's sheep, for she was a shepherdess. Now, as soon as Jacob saw Rachel, the daughter of Laban, his mother's brother, and the sheep of Laban, his mother's brother, Jacob went near and rolled a stone from the well's mouth and watered the flock of Laban, his mother's brother. Then Jacob kissed Rachel, and he wept aloud, and Jacob told Rachel that he was her father's kinsman, and that he was Rebekah's son, and she ran and told her father. Verse 13. As soon as Laban heard the news about Jacob, his sister's son, he ran and met him and embraced him and kissed him and brought him to the house of house. Jacob told Laban all these things, and Laban said to him, surely you are my bone and my flesh, and he stayed with him for a month. Then Laban said to Jacob, because you are my kinsman, should you therefore serve me for nothing? Tell me what shall be your wages. Now Laban had two daughters. The name of the older was Leah, and the name of the younger Rachel. Leah's eyes were weak. That's Bible code for she wasn't pleasant to look at. But Rachel was beautiful in form and appearance. Jacob loved Rachel and said, I will serve you 7 years, fellas. Note that. Serve you 7 years for your younger daughter, Rachel. Laban said, it is better that I give her to you than I should give her to another man. Stay with me. So Jacob served 7 years for Rachel, and they seemed to him a few days because of his love, the love he had for her. Verse 21. Then Jacob said to Laban, give me my wife that I may go into her, for my time is completed. So, here's where the soap opera comes in. Laban gathered together all the people of the place and made a feast. But in the evening, he took his daughter Leah, weak of eyes, and brought her to Jacob, and he went into her. Laban gave his female servant Zilpah, the daughter of Leah, to be her servant. In the morning, behold, it was Leah. And Jacob said to Laban, what is it you have done to me? Did I not serve with you for Rachel? Why have you deceived me? Laban said, Is it not done in your country to give the younger daughter before the firstborn? Complete the week of this one, and we will give you and the other also in return for serving me another 17 years, counting 14 years. Jacob did so and completed the week. Then Laban gave him his daughter Rachel to be her wife. Laban gave his female servant Bilhah to be
the daughter of Rachel to be her servant. So Jacob went into Rachel also, and he loved Rachel more than Leah, and served Laban for another 7 years. What on earth is going on here? This is a crazy passage. Here, note that we've got four main characters that we're going to look at. This is the context that we're going to look at today within the next few verses here. We've got four main characters. The first character we're going to look at is God. And notice that God within this story is somewhat absent. And that's actually an important point for us to note, that God isn't brought up much in this, and we need to frame that around our lives of how often are we bringing God into our lives here. The second character in the story is Jacob. Not a great start to married life for him, right? He's living in pagan Mesopotamia. He's already worked 7 years for his joke uncle. Now he's got to work another for the woman that he loves, which is character number three, Rachel. Right? Rachel is the wife that Jacob has chosen to marry, and yet he has another wife which he is neither attracted to or loves, and that is character number four, Leah. And both Rachel and Leah are fighting for Jacob's attention, both in two very different ways for two very different reasons. But before we jump into the messiness of this next portion of Scripture, I want us to notice one important thing. Despite all the mess that Jacob, Leah, and Rachel created, this is the genesis, or the beginning, of God's great beloved nation, Israel. You realize that? Maybe when Andrew was reading the passage, you heard some names that were familiar to you, and you were trying to put your finger on what that was. Through this mess were the nations of Israel that we see throughout the entirety of the Old Testament, and that brought us into the New Testament where Jesus came from. Think about that for a second. No matter how crazy our lives are, whether it's self-imposed or not, God's plan always works out. It always works out. That no matter what we bring to the equation, his story will reign true. So, to where Andrew brought us, Genesis 29, verse 31 says this. Then the Lord saw that Leah was hated. And here, hated isn't the same context as it is in English. It just means she was unloved. But then the Lord saw that Leah was hated. He opened her womb, but Rachel was barren. See, Rachel's womb was closed and Leah's was open. One wife was desperate to be loved, Leah, and one wife was desperate for children, Rachel. So first, Rachel, she was desperate to have kids. She was devastated. I mean, imagine the 7 years that Jacob had been working for her father. She was probably in her mind recreating what her life was going to be like, right? That they were going to have this great wedding, this great marriage. She was going to have a lot of kids, that they were going to ride off into the sunset, and yet none of this had happened. This wasn't how she thought things were going to turn out. First, and this is kind of awkward, but probably having your sister as now like your husband's wife is a little weird, a little awkward. You probably didn't picture marriage to be that way. Second, she was barren, which in this culture especially was extremely shameful. And then third, to top it all off, Leah was just pumping out kids with no problem at all. I mean, over that 7 years, like four sons were born from her, and Rachel was devastated. But on the flip side, unloved Leah must have been filled with so much hope. So much hope in this time. We actually see within the next few verses, her barometer of hope came through the naming of her children, the naming of her four boys that came from her in those 7 years that Jacob was working for his rightful wife. First was Reuben, which literally means, look, a son. In verse 32, it says this. Then Leah conceived and bore a son, and she called his name Reuben, for she said, Because the Lord has looked upon my affliction, for now my husband will love me. Just think of the excitement that she had. A son. Perhaps now Jacob will look at me and he will love me because of this gift that I have given him. And yet she remained unloved. So number two, Simeon. which means the Lord has heard. Verse 33, she conceived again and bore a son and said, because the Lord has heard that I am hated, he has given me this son also. And she called his name Simeon. Now the Lord has heard me. Perhaps Jacob will too. Perhaps he will hear me. He will notice me. He will love me like he does my sister Rachel. And yet she remained unloved. Son number three, Levi, which means attachment. Verse 34. Again, she conceived and bore a son and said, now this time my husband will be attached to me because I have borne him three sons. Therefore, she called him Levi. Notice poor Leah here is not asking for love, just attachment. Just to be noticed, her hope is slowly fading. And then comes son number four, Judah, which means praise. And she conceived again and bore a son and said, this time I will praise the Lord. Therefore, she called his name Judah, and she ceased bearing. Leah makes no plea for improved relationship with her husband. She has no hope left. Over these 7 years, she is slowly figuring out that that love will never come. She does not focus on God until this moment where she starts to look at him again and see that maybe there's a different blessing in store for her. And I wish that she could have sinned, fast-forwarded through the centuries and sinned this blessing, because here's where it's so cool to see the context of God's great story. Because guess what? The last two sons, Levi and Judah, those are the tribes. The Levi is the priestly tribe, the Levites, the priestly tribe. And Judah is the kingly tribe. That these are the two of the greatest tribes that came out of Israel. And if Leah were able to look forward, she would see through her bloodline people like Aaron and Moses and King David, and Jesus Christ came through her descendants. She was blessed. But at this point, she didn't. Honestly, that's okay. It wasn't okay how she dealt with it, how she handles her lack of feeling blessed, but we all go through times where we don't necessarily feel God. Many of us have had highs in our relationship with God, whether it's a camp high or a mission trip or a friend coming to know the Lord or an Easter or some moment in our life where it is a spiritual high, and that is to be praised, but that's not the entirety of our life. It's kind of equated to marriage, right? Like Pam and I are stepping up to our 15th year of marriage, and our whole marriage hasn't all been this high. Actually, the strength of our marriage has come through the dull parts. And if you guys are married for any length of time, you know that your strength is through the normality of life. And it's the same with our relationship with God. We lean in so much on feelings. We rely on how we feel that our relationship with God is hurt from it. If we're feeling good, then God is good. And if we're feeling bad, if life circumstances aren't great, then God is bad, or he is mad at us, or he is absent. And honestly, it's exhausting when we rely on feelings. This is for Danielle. Christianity is like golf. You're welcome, Danielle. Those of you guys who are golf lovers out there, some days are birdie days, and some days are bogey days, right? Some days you feel like you're hitting the green every time, and other days you're pitching into the rough. And we need to realize that that's life. That on those bogey days, instead of throwing our clubs in the lake and storming off, that we need to realize that we get to play golf rather than burn in hell. Bad analogy, I know. But we get to play golf. We get to see the beauty of creation on this 18-hole course or whatever the case may be. And sometimes we fixate so much on it's a bogey day, it's a bad day, that we let our feelings take over. And in this circumstance, Leah let her feelings take over her, and she forgot to admire the view, to realize that she is a child of God. And we do that so often also. Now, on the other hand, we have Rachel again, and her depression is growing deeper and deeper with every one of Leah's births, and envy grips her soul. Envy is hugely rampant in our culture, especially in the church. And here's what envy does. It diminishes our blessing and puffs up the blessing of others. We struggle with this in Imprint Church. We do. We're constantly looking at our friends, and it goes back to our story, and saying, oh, I wish I had that job. I wish I had their kids. I wish I had their house or looked like them. And it diminishes the blessing that we have. We all probably experienced it. If you have kids, the last couple of weeks, we had Easter egg hunts, right? And at least with my youngest boys, we were out at my wife's cousin's place, and they have a huge plot of land, and we, as all families, brought all our eggs. There was like 1,000 Easter eggs out there, and all the kids went out, and they spent about 20 minutes filling up their bags, and Danny, my youngest, comes back, and he's pumped. He's got a bag full of eggs. He looks at all the candy in there, and he is so excited just to basically try and eat that candy before we get home that night, which he almost did. But then guess what happens? It's Jackson, his older brother, comes, and he's got twice as many eggs in his bag, and Danny throws a fit. Now he looks at his blessing and says, oh, it's not as good as his, and it's diminished. And we do this in our life all the time, where we look at someone else's bag of candy and say, they've got more than me. Why can't I have what they have? And it diminishes the blessing that we have. And this is where Rachel is at in this point in the story. In her anguish, she forgets God. And it's important for us to know that her emotions get the best of her too. Just like Leah. Chapter 30, verses 1 and 2. When Rachel saw that she bore Jacob no children, she envied her sister. She said to Jacob, give me a children or I shall die. Jacob's anger was kindled against Rachel, and he said, am I in the place of God who has withheld from you the fruit of the womb? Her plan was, once again, to marry Jacob, to have a ton of kids, to live happily ever after, and that had not happened for her yet. So she comes up with another plan to step up the birth wars with Leah and to have her way to try and catch up to her sister Leah. She believed that God's story for her was to marry Jacob and to ride off into the sunset. And when it didn't happen, she turned to her own plan. Does this sound familiar to anyone in the room? I think we all have that. Well, God, I trust you. But if you don't show up in the next 5 minutes, I'm going to have to do my own thing because I don't have time to wait for you. Right? It might not be 5 minutes. It might be a week. It might be a month. It might be 10 years. Waiting on God when we are so stinking impatient is one of the hardest disciplines of being a Christian. And yet we are called to do it because His blessing is greater than ours. She doesn't wait on him. Rachel started to write her own story. And the funny thing is, it actually turns out well for her. Verses 3 through 6, through 8, sorry. Oops, I was already there. Then she said, here is my servant Bilhah. Go into her so that she may give birth on my behalf, that even I may have children through her. So she gave him to her servant Bilhah as his wife, and Jacob went into her, and Bilhah conceived and bore Jacob a son. Then Rachel said, God has judged me and has also heard my voice and given me a son. Therefore, she called his name Dan. Rachel's servant Bilhah conceived again and bore Jacob a second son, and then Rachel said, with mighty wrestlings, I have wrestled with my sister and have prevailed. So she called his name Naphtali. Dan means vindicated. Naphtali means wrestling. Rachel is saying, my tenacity paid off. My tenacity paid off. In all these wrestlings with God, he has honored me. Watch out, Rachel. I am gaining. It's an interesting point that we have to realize here, that sometimes we confuse success with the blessing of God, and she's doing that too. Just because her plan worked doesn't mean that it was a blessing from God. But Leah knows how to play this game too. Verse 9, when Leah saw that she had ceased bearing children, she took her servant Zilpah and gave her to Jacob as a wife. Then Leah's servant Zilpah bore Jacob a son, and Leah said, "Good fortune has come." So she called his name Gad. Leah's servant Zilpah bore Jacob a second son, and Leah said, "Happy am I, for women." Look at this. "For women have called me happy." So she called his name Asher. Gad means good fortune. Asher means happy. "Bye-bye, Rachel. I'm up 6-2 now. Eat my dust. You're never going to catch me. The birth wars continue." So we look at this and we say, all right, can it get any messier? Of course it can. We're going to jump into that here. Verse 14. "In the days of the wheat harvest, Reuben," who's Leah's oldest, "went out and found mandrakes in the field and brought them to his mother Leah." So here's what mandrakes are, right? Mandrakes in this time were considered, and this is from the Bible, not from Harry Potter, but a love potion. Yeah, love potions in the Bible, go figure. These were they were seen as a love potion. In the ancient times, they were considered as a way of helping barren women concede. And actually, the Hebrew word for mandrake basically is the same word for love. And many people back then called mandrakes love apples. Apples for free. The power of the mandrake is obviously mythical and not scientific, but it is clear that both Rachel and Leah believed this. That they believed that these mandrakes had this mythical power, and whoever had the mandrakes was gonna get pregnant, right? So they were fighting for that. So the end of verse 14, we continue. Then Rachel said to Leah, "Please give me some of your son's mandrakes." But she said to her, "Is it a small matter that you have taken away my husband? Would you take away my son's mandrakes also?" Rachel said, "Then, I got an idea, then he may lie with you tonight in exchange for your son's mandrakes." When Jacob came from the field in the evening, Leah went out to meet him and said, "For you must come with me, for I have hired you," gross, "with my son's mandrakes." So he lay with her that night. Okay, super ugly, it's in the Bible, so we're reading it. But now, it's not obvious here, but we can assume at this point that Rachel kind of held the keys to the bedroom there, and Leah hadn't been given any rights to sleep with her husband, so, or otherwise this wouldn't have been a good deal for Leah, but we're picturing that's probably the case, so they make the trade, right? In verse 17, we see God's sense of humor come into play. "And God listened to Leah, who gave up the mandrakes, the love potion, and she conceived and bore Jacob a fifth son. Leah said, 'God has given me my wages because I gave my servant to my husband.' So she called his name Issachar. And Leah conceived again, and she bore Jacob a sixth son. Then Leah said, 'God has endowed me with this good endowment. Now my husband will honor me because I have borne him a sixth son,' and she called him Zebulun. Afterwards, she bore a daughter and called her Dinah." I love this, once again, because God's sense of humor is in play here. Because he spits in the face of superstition. The person that should have got pregnant because they had the love potion, Rachel, does not. And Leah, who gives up the love potion, gets pregnant not once or twice, but three times in a row. And note in verse 17 that God is still in control here. God is working through this mess. And Leah, at this point, is on top. Meanwhile, Rachel is at rock bottom. And she, in this time, and hopefully that you see this in our stories too, is because she's at rock bottom, she's got nowhere else to turn, she turns back to the Lord and once again prays for a child. Verses 22 to 24. "Then God remembered Rachel, and God listened to her and opened her womb, and she conceived and bore a son and said, 'God has taken away my reproach.' And she called his name Joseph, saying, 'My Lord, add to me another.'" Joseph, we all recognize that name. And later on in the story, she bears the 12th son, the 12th tribe of Israel, Benjamin. She finally gives up her scheming. There's no surrogates. There's no mandrakes. She stops trying to write her own story. So let's land the plane here with an important observation. The passage that we chose today starts and ends
with the same statement. God opened her womb. At the beginning, and that initially with Leah and ends with Rachel, but at the beginning, at the end, and in the middle of the mess, God is at work. His story prevails through all the scheming, the manipulation, the surrogate competition, the love potions, the selling of intimacy, the gloating, the humiliation, the tears of the loveless, the tears of the childless. God takes the mess of man and uses it for his glory. God in this story didn't have any trouble in working out his will. And guess what? In our lives, he doesn't have any trouble working it out either. Human determination or even cleverness never outweighs God's story. So we're back to where we started. God's story or mine? God's story or mine? Many of us, as we are teaching our kids how to crawl, use the Cheerio. Where you put a Cheerio about 3 or 4 feet away from them, and you tempt them to get off their little butts and start to crawl towards the Cheerio. And if you're a mean dad like me, when they get close, you move the Cheerio a little bit further, right? What happens when the kid gets the Cheerio? Plops in its mouth and it's happy as can be, right? No. Automatically does the universal sign for give me 10 times that much, right? Everyone knows this one. Because the momentary pleasure of that Cheerio is gone, like that, and they want more. When we choose our own story, we live that life every day, because it will never, ever suffice. For some of us in this room, we need to choose to jump into God's story. It might be a first-time decision, because at this moment in time, you are realizing that I've done it my way, and it's not working. I'd encourage you during our prayer time just to go to talk to someone about it. Maybe you have a ton of questions. We'd love to answer them for you. For the majority of us in this room, we need to daily get our feet out of bed and make that choice. Whose story am I writing today? Am I writing my story or God's? And when we put our feet back in the bed the evening after a long day to reflect and think back, how did I do? Because probably 8 times out of 10, we may have failed. But by God's grace, we are still his children. And the next day, we get to try again. For everyone in this room, we make a million choices every day. My challenge to us as a church is just to pause and ask that question, whose story am I writing? Mine or God's? Do I want to continue to chase after the Cheerio, to live in the gargoyle ball court? Or do I want to be a part of something so much bigger where there's so much more blessing and I might not feel it right now, but it is so